We can start.
We can start. We can start.
Ah, nice, chilly, and rainy afternoon here in Bangalore. I'm going to speak about something which is so taken for granted. As it is, as I always tell, that in mental health, there is so much of ignorance, there is so much of stigma. To me, depression is the equivalent of fever or temperature. In physical health, people have fever. All of us have fever sometime or the other. If I have some 99 degrees fever, I got wet in the rain and then, you know, I was having fever. What happens is that I say, okay, maybe I need to rest it off. I need to keep myself warm. Little more and I say, okay, let me take a paracetamol or let me take some grandmother's remedy. Wait and watch, rest it off for some time, sleep over it. And by next day, if it is over, I do acknowledge that I had fever yesterday, but thankfully it was minor and now I am okay, I can continue. If it is a little higher, then what do? I go to the doctor and the doctor says that I'll give you this, maybe antibiotics or whatever it is. It takes 2-3 days time and it comes out. If it is higher than that and it is persisting, then the doctor says, I'll do a test. I'll do some diagnostics, find out, do your blood test and this and that. Find out the cause of the fever and then treat you accordingly. So like that, why I'm telling you this is because there are stages. Fever can be something very minor, which you can just overcome overnight. Or fever can be something which requires days and weeks of treatment and proper investigation, and then only it comes out. Okay, the same thing is there with depression. Depression is the most common mental health disorder. But even if I mention that depression is a mental health disorder, people get upset. People say, what do you mean? Yeah, I'm depressed because I was disappointed. I was supposed to get that something which I didn't get. Or because of this happened or that happened, it happens, it's okay. Sometimes people even go to deep depression where they become dysfunctional and yet they don't want to acknowledge. They say it is because of the circumstances, you know, because I lost my job, because I had some such situation. What's so great? It's not depression as such. But aren't the symptoms all pointing to the fact that you are depressed? A little later, we'll go into the definition of depression, how do you identify and all these things. But the only important thing that I want to tell you is that depression is not the same as sadness. These two are confused. A sad person need not necessarily be depressed. And a depressed person, in most cases, is sad, but not necessarily and not to an extreme purpose. Now the most important thing to keep in mind is sadness can come and go. Sadness is an emotion like any other emotion. It can even be momentary. When I heard that such and such friend of mine has had an accident, I felt very sad. Then I checked up with some common friends and this and that and found that no, it's not serious. It was an accident, but luckily he escaped with very minor injuries. The sadness just disappears there and then, right? But depression is something which is a little more deeper. Just one small thing I wanted to clarify about depression, and that is that depression can be primarily of two types. There are more and this and that. We won't go into the clinical or the medical aspects of it. But in general, one can classify into two areas. One is the most common one, which is what I would call as reactive depression, meaning to say that I am depressed as a reaction to something that is happening to me. The other is endogenous. Endogenous is where nothing is happening to me. No sad events, no setbacks or failures, but yet I am feeling very depressed. And when I say depressed, what am I actually feeling? I am losing my motivation to work. I'm not in a good mood. I can't even enjoy some joke or sense of humor. I can't appreciate the things which I normally used to do. I get into what behavioral scientists refer to as dysthymia, meaning to say I can't enjoy life. I can't do the routine things which I'm supposed to be able to do. And I start going into a negative frame of mind. Anyway, when these things do happen, as I said, that it can be very, very minor, like the fever which goes away overnight, the depression can also go away overnight. It could be something very serious. Now, where is the dividing line? If this depression makes me dysfunctional, see, if the depression is there in the sense that I'm feeling sad, I'm feeling pulled down, my motivation level is low, but I'm still functional. I'm still doing the normal things which are needed of me. I'm still maintaining my overall, you know, close relationships and things like that. But if I become dysfunctional, I don't feel like going to work or studying for my exams. I don't even feel like talking to my nearest and dearest people. I stop enjoying some basic things. I don't want to meet. If somebody comes to meet me, I just say that, no, tell him I'm not at home and send them off. When it comes to that, I'm becoming dysfunctional, right? Now, if this dysfunctionality comes and goes, fine, no problem. It can happen to any one of us. Sorry. But if I become so dysfunctional for a sufficient period of time that it can cause some sort of irreversible damage to my studies, damage to my work, damage to my relationships, damage to something which is important to me. So if the depression makes me dysfunctional for a long enough period of time that I may have some permanent irreversible damage, I would call that as clinical depression, which requires the help of, you know, professionals. So keeping that in mind, at the first level, what do people like you and me do? We try to support a person who is becoming depressed. Or if I myself realize that I am depressed, then I use my own techniques to pull out of it. I may be a person who is a firm believer in God. So what do? I have my faith in God. I pray, I meditate, I do all these things. The mind and body are connected to each other. So if I'm that type of person who goes in for walking, jogging, gymming, punching a bag, taking off on a quick vacation to a new place, the body feels nicer and the body tells the mind to be nicer, right? So we do that. But what we are going to discuss is three or four very important things. One is how to identify that it is actually depression and not just a passing phase of feeling sad. Also, I would like to discuss with you what happens to a person, you know, who are the type of people who are more prone to depression. Understand that. You know, people who have a negative bent of mind, who are pessimistic, who look at things in a negative way. I don't know whether I'll pass the exam. I don't know whether I'll get that increment. I don't know whether my relationship with so and so will improve or continue to get worse. So if in general, even if you're not suffering from depression, but if you have that frame of mind, in general, if you're that type of person, or you know somebody who is of that type, please become aware that the chances of that person going into depression when something goes wrong are much, much higher than those who have a optimistic and a positive, frame of mind. That is something that I want us to always keep in mind. Okay, if you are the type of person who's doing it and who's telling others also to do it, what are the factors that we need to, understand? One is, of course, the signs of what indicates that, yes, I am perhaps going into depression, or I have if I have situations where I get into, a depression type of thing. How is the behavior to be? Obviously, the mind is not an organ, so the mind doesn't give you indications. There are no diagnostic tools to assess the mind. So you have to get it by the behavior. I also want to present to you today some of the, myths surrounding depression. Somehow people have a very wrong notion. You see a person who is otherwise very happy, who is leading his life normally, doing things fine. But then suddenly what happens is he goes into depression. And as I told you, he loses interest in what he's doing. He doesn't talk properly to people. He's not very efficient in whatever he has been doing. He develops a negative frame of mind. What happens to such people? Others who have no idea about mental health, what they do is they start telling him, what's wrong with this guy? Why is he behaving like this? No, it is because he didn't get the increment. So what? Other people also don't get increments. What's so great about it? Or other people also go through some illness or go through some relationship issues. What's so great about it? And they say, don't be so lazy. Don't be such a crybaby. And they start telling the person, come on, get up, move. There are well-intentioned people who come and say, come, tomorrow is Sunday, we are all going for a nice picnic. Come with us and you'll feel nice. You know what happens to that person? If he forces himself to go for that picnic, he looks around. There are 2, 4, 6, 8 friends of his along people. What happens is, it becomes more obvious to me that I am the only person who is not enjoying. I am the only person who is mentally suffering. And when he compares himself with the others who are thoroughly enjoying themselves, he starts getting more depressed. So we'll also talk about the myths that surround depression and what we need to be careful about. And then, of course, lastly, we need to be aware how to overcome depression. I've already told you that if it is clinical depression, if despite talking over, despite counseling and therapy, despite doing nice activities and all that, if the person is still dysfunctional, if the person is not able to get back, then remember that you need to go for professional help with a mental health professional. But short of that, for people who have not gone to that extreme, which happens very often, estimates have shown that maybe 30 to 40% of people at any time, succumb to depression, at least temporarily or for a short while, such a large number. So the final thing that we are going to talk about today is how to overcome the depression. Once you identify that either you yourself are depressed or somebody known to you is depressed, how do you actually overcome that? So these four factors, what Sonal and Purnima have done is, to make it easy and to make it very clear, they have made it into some, you know, bullet points. And we are presenting that as a sort of slideshow. So you can click a photograph, or you can jot it down, or you can do whatever you want with it. But the main idea being that if you could become aware of that, many of you, I'm sure, are already working with people under depression and all that, and now doing your bit. I keep getting some wonderful feedback from some of our friends and old students who are doing very good work in the area of depression. But for those who want to sharpen their skills further, there are ways and means by which you can do it. So here are these slides which Purni is going to present to you. After that, we will start with our discussion.
ऐसे इस तरह पूरा यस पूरा थोड़ा घुमा यू नो व्हाई इट आंखों से चश्मा का Good afternoon. So I thought I'll just take you through some points so that as you keep looking at it, you will kind of be able to, as mentioned, take snapshots or just mull over it. So, and then connect it to people who may have gone through it or who are going through it. And that will give you a fairly good idea how to help them through these difficult, challenging times. So this is the inability to concentrate. So be it, you know, normal office work or household work, or if you were a person who would concentrate and read the newspaper for half an hour, 45 minutes or something, it will be like a tough task for you to concentrate. And then you'll be like, even deciding, do I go here or do I not go here? Do I have to go and meet this person? It will be so indecisive for this person to really call the shots. So that is the inability to concentrate and make decisions. Loss of interest in things going around you. So if you are a person who would be interested, you know, in the morning when you wake up and you are doing your normal chores and getting ready for the day, possibly you put on some songs or you put on some bhajan or something like that. Different people do different things, right? Or you may get up, go and water the plants. But even that would be like, oh my God, do I have to do this every day? And I don't really think I want to do it today. I wish it rains and the plants get watered themselves. And you'll be very critical about whatever you are doing. So self-criticism is making, you know, in your heart, making comments in your mind about your own self. Oh, see, I can't even read the newspaper. I can't even water the plants. And what am I doing? Or you blame yourself for anything that happens in and around your life. Small instances also, you will start blaming yourself. Loathing, self-loathing is in a way like making some hate statements about yourself. I'm no good. I don't think I'm worth it. And things like that keep happening. So this is something that we need to watch out for. Look at this small, cute clip art which says, pointless to grow up. Because you feel, what is the point? There is no point in doing anything. There are some people, you know, who like to say, maybe draw something or do some Zentangle or do something like that. They will lose interest in even those small activities. Some people would just stand in the balcony, watch down, you know, children play, or they would just read some, do some Sudoku. Those activities will be very listless for them. That does not appeal to them anymore. Pessimism is total opposite of optimism, where you feel that, no, I don't think I see any meaning in all these things. Situations are going to be just like this for me. Life, I don't think, is going to improve on from here anymore. And what can I also do to improve it? You know, so being a little negative, pessimistic, not having hope that things can improve for you, that is also one of the features. Yes. There are some people who would, you know, want to look at the positive side of things. They'll say that, hey, it's okay, it's done, no problem. Come on, let me just dust myself, get up, dress up, show up. That is the optimistic way of doing things. Whereas here, if the person is, you know, visibly depressed, the attempt is like more on problems, on negatives, and generally having a bad feeling, which is, no, I think because of this only things are happening, and no, I don't think I feel like eating this, and I don't think, you know, my day is going bad. I mean, I think this is what I deserve. So that is a very, you know, like a downtrending kind of a thought process the person has. And his thoughts are always with only problems and whatever he has gone wrong with. And these can lead to a very large extent to self-sabotage or doing self-harm, which we say believing that you deserve to be punished. So even a small thing, like if you've fallen down or something, you say, yeah, because this happened, today I have fallen down. If somebody scolds or if there is a loss or anything like that, suddenly you find that your fast tag is not working and you're on your drive, you will say, yeah, I deserve to be punished because this is what has happened and I think this is what I deserve. So even any activity which goes a little against you, you start thinking that you deserve to be punished. And with all these things which are happening in and around you, the tendency to harm yourself is very strong. So you will constantly think of, you know, okay, what's the point? Maybe I could harm myself. I could, you know, sabotage my own safety. That also is a very strong feeling that can come up during these times. Look at all these different smileys that are put up. Sadness, feeling miserable, and you wouldn't want to, the person would not want to look at the bright side of things at all. Constantly you will find unhappiness, sadness, being morose, dismayed will keep enveloping you all the time. There will be a loss of pleasure. For example, let's assume if somebody has brought you a piece of sweet, if you have a sweet tooth, or if you think that you're a person who likes ice cream or certain kind of savouries, even if somebody comes and gives it to you, you'll feel like, what is the use? It's okay, not that it brings great thing. What? Okay, I'll eat one piece. What is the big deal? So there is total loss of pleasure, satisfaction. There are some people who really like to have that hot cup of tea, or they would like to have hot soup on a rainy day. It does not really matter to them at all. That enjoyment is not there. Okay, so I think this slides which are going to come up now are quite explanatory with what is put up here. It's a red flag which you have to look out for in the person for the behavioral changes. Okay, yeah, so you have reduced activity levels, doing less than usual, which means that I have also met a lot of people who would say that this thing is taking so much of a toll on me that I only have to compulsorily get up to make some lunch for my child because he or she has to go to school. Otherwise, I'm not the least interested in eating or drinking and don't want to do anything like that. Even that is a huge big effort. I would just want to pack some bread and some cheese and just push it into the lunchbox. But the school is insistent, and because of that, I have to force myself to do things, but for my sake, I have no interest in doing anything. So it everything feels like a huge, big Herculean task. Difficult to get out of bed. You almost want to be friends with the sun god and tell him that don't come out. Just delay your coming out. You be where you are. I have no interest, no inclination in getting out of bed. Even say, usually what happens, let's assume you have something very urgent to do. Even if you have slept late, you'll quickly get up. No? You'll quickly get up, make that cup of tea, feel a little spruced up, and then you will start at least doing the most urgent thing that is needed for the family. Whereas here what happens is, even if you had had a long duration of sleep, which could be enough of 8 to 10 or whatever, you'll still feel that, no, I don't think I want to just get out of this bed at all, or see anyone, meet anyone, brush my teeth, or make that even cup of tea for myself. Yeah, I think the picture over here speaks 1,000 words, right? Withdrawal from people, work, relaxation, or pleasures. So we are, in a way, coming back to this point again and again, that I've also seen there are some people who would have their very favorite people, grandchildren, cousins, or nieces, or nephews, and they would be like, oh my God, I have to meet them now. I don't think I want to do it. You say, hey, you like being with them at some point of time. You say, not anymore. I don't think I want to meet them. I don't want to have a pleasantry talk with them. I don't think I want to do anything like that. Work also. Be any kind of a work. Now, let's assume if you're the kind who keeps your wardrobe very clean and you are very house proud, you keep your, you know, your table and your shelves and everything very neat, spick and span. It matters to hoots for you whether it is neat or not neat. Relaxation or pleasures, nothing matters to you. Yeah. See, look at this picture. I think that itself tells a lot of things, that this man is doing one thing on top and below there is something else happening. There is restlessness. You don't know you're going left or right. A part of you is going left, a part of you is going right. And that also brings in, as we put in the earlier slide, that there is a lot of indecisiveness. You're just crying. You'll feel that, no, I'm what's happening to me? But tears will just be, you know, coming out of your eyes. You will not have any control. You will be, what do I do about this? But you may not be able to do anything. There will be, and everything will be like, if you say, hey, how are you? I'm okay, fine, not too good. And then you will, are you not well? No, I'm well. But no, okay. So it's almost that, again, this gets connected to pessimism. There is sighing, groaning. Even getting up of the bed is a, you know, big pressured task. Sitting down is a pressured task. Or if somebody's saying, hey, come down, let's have some lunch, I've served lunch, you'll be like, oh my God, now to get up from the bed, wash my hands, wash my face, go sit on the table, on the chair, and eat. Everything is very, very laborious. Now we are coming to some of the myths that we hear about depression, which are it's not a real illness, it's all in your head. Because see, typically if a depressed person is doing whatever we just mentioned about the behavior and what are the signs and symptoms, it kind of becomes akin to laziness, right? So you feel that, hey, yeah, I know this person, no, is trying to just find some excuses to do things. I don't think that's a real thing at all. He's just trying to make it up. So one of the myth is, it is not a real illness. It is only in your head. So they'll say, just go brainwash, go clear your head and come. It doesn't work like that. The other myth is, can be overcome by willpower or will go away by itself. So it is not like sometimes like a headache or a pain, or just you hurt your hand against the door and then for a while your hand aches, and then after half an hour, 45 minutes, you feel the pain reducing, right? It is not so that it will just go away by itself. So that is another myth which we need to demystify. It happens when you face a sad situation, so don't be sad. Many people generally believe that, look, so what? This has happened to you. Not a big deal. You don't be sad about it, okay? Now, if I say don't be sad about it, can the person start being happy again? Or if somebody says, hey, come, let's go out for a movie and for a, for an ice cream or for a pizza. And does the sadness just vanish like that? No, for that person, it does not. And it happens when you face a sad situation. No, there are quite a few people who have a good threshold to face sadness. So they may have that sadness after a point of time. That sadness can go away because the event has, you know, bettered itself. Or possibly this person has the threshold to handle sadness. So people telling that, hey, don't be sad, doesn't work. Just get involved in your work, keep busy, and it will go away. It does not go away. In fact, your impetus, your interest to do work only has gone down. So just by getting involved in work, it is chances that the depression will go away is not too, it's rare. If your parents had depression, you will get it too. This is one of the strongest myths which so many people say, no, my grandfather also had, so I think so. That is the reason why my brother is also having. No, it is not so. That's only a myth. Okay, I think this is very clear. Mostly only women get depression, and talking about it only makes it worse. No, we need to open up. We need to talk about it and get a perspective from another person. Yeah, I think I'm sure when Ali comes here to have your thoughts and opinions, maybe we'll have more on that antidepressants are dangerous, addictive, and you have to take them lifelong. No, not at all. You don't have to do that at all. There are, you know, proper methods by which the dosages can come down. And once you feel you're a little sorted and can manage situations well, you can be absolutely off antidepressants. Another myth is people telling that he is lazy. Some bhoot preth has, you know, captured him, and things are going wrong because of this. No, it is not that at all. And some people telling, hey, what is the big deal? Yeah, I have more tension than you. I'm never getting depressed. For these small things, you get depressed. We have to understand that each person has got a different threshold of himself to manage or not being able to manage things. So these are some of the myths about depression, yes. And how do we overcome that? Yes Ali?
Please. Sure. Okay. If we are clear about all these factors, let's come to the most important and the final point. How do we overcome depression? So please be aware that you have depression or somebody has depression, and a lot can be done about it. The first point, very, very obvious, is do not be alone. Get support, get love, get understanding from wherever it can come. Sometimes it can even be from your pet. Sometimes it could be from your friends, colleagues, relatives. But look for people who are positive minded and who accept you as you are, without all those, you know, the you are lazy, witchcraft and all these things. Similarly, I had mentioned to you that there's a different, the mind and body are connected to each other. So if you push yourself, even force yourself if necessary, not to remain idle, not to be just sitting and brooding, not to be, you know, lazing around. Get up, do whatever you can in terms of pleasurable activities. Then comes a change of place and situation. If you can do that, no, you don't have to go all the way to the Himalayas as this picture shows you, but anywhere, a change of place. Maybe you can go to your sister's house or cousin's house, stay a weekend over there, or go over somewhere for something, pick up some activity which has been pending since a long time, and use this as an excuse to finish it off. A change of place and situation definitely helps. You're all aware, things like prayer, yoga, meditation, physical exercise, mindfulness, these are all proven things. They have been proven over the years and maybe some of them even centuries, but they do help. I do understand and acknowledge that when you are feeling depressed, you don't feel like doing all these. My request is push yourself, force yourself to do it. Slowly it will become easier and easier. Okay. Then start setting some very small short-term goals. One of the best things to do is to help others. The moment you see somebody who is in a worse off situation in some way, it could be financially, it could be health-wise, it could be relationship-wise, it could be in whatever way. The moment you look at people who are in some way or the other worse off than you, and if you start helping them, if you make a small support group, if you start getting people together and say, okay, let me help. In this, one of the classic examples most of you are aware is our helping hands. Volunteers of helping hands who go to the hospital even once a week for 2-3 hours. They find such great relief, you know, when situations go bad, when they're facing situations which could pull them down and make them depressed. When they go to the hospital or they go to the counseling center and they see other people, things really help. The same way, you should not close yourself to counseling. See, you should be open to the idea. Whether it is formal, you know, labeled counseling, or whether it is this friend or this elder person, you know, who always gives you a listening ear and who's there for you, who gives you that unconditional emotional support, seek out such a person. And at a time when you are likely to be feeling depressed, make sure that you spend some regular time with such a person. These are some of the very basic things. There's a very long list, you know, when we are actually counseling somebody for depression, we explore in different areas. We try to find out whether this works or that works, whether this will help or that will. It's always a trial and error, thing. Yes, Sarda has asked for contact for helping hands. So we'll give you both our office number as well as the coordinator of helping hands is Mr. Ganesh. We'll give you his phone number also. You can jot it down. Call up sometime and, you know, fix up and go and visit one of the hospitals or counseling center or wherever it is. Get a feel of it for yourself. And this, for those of you who are interested, I can tell you, is also a vaccination against depression. We had a helping hand volunteer who was married for 50 odd years. His wife suddenly passed away without warning. He finished all the rituals and the next morning he was back on his duty at the desk. And he said so. He said, if I sit at home, I'm going to be very, very depressed. But when I come here, I have like-minded people, I have co-volunteers, I have friends, and I also see other people who are suffering badly because of illness and death, and that gives me a boost. This is how we go about the thing. Yes, Vinita rightly says, sometimes people are going through depression, but they are not able to recognize, or address and get caught up in many myths And slowly it starts getting deeper and deeper. Yes, like in any other ailment, anything which is not nipped in the bud, which is kept pending or which is under denial, can keep growing. We know this about physical ailments. We are always warned, okay, you have this fever, but don't take it easy. It may grow. It may become something more serious. Go ahead and see that you get the proper remedy for it. Same thing applies for depression, as I told you. It's the most common, you know, mental illness. So if the moment you identify it in yourself or somebody, please pick it up immediately. Okay. Surekha says, good humor. Oh, yes, Surekha, I missed that out. Good humor is a tonic for mind and body. It's the best antidote for anxiety and depression. It attracts and keeps friends. It lightens human burdens. Very true, very true. Develop that sense of humor, and that will be another vaccination against future depression. Surek also says, an elderly gentleman I know is beginning to get depressed because of reduced mobility. Means to say, not being able to walk around or move around as he used to do in his younger days. He was earlier very active and is now feeling limited and restricted and grieving the loss of a lifetime he once had. How can I help him better? Yes, Surekha, the first thing is to ask him what he feels, how he feels, what are the things which make him saddest, what are the things which are taking away his you know, motivation to do something. Take him into the past and make him relive the things that he used to do. We have one of our counselors whose father used to be a very, very active professional, and he started, his health started going down, and he went into such a severe depression. He started, you know, just sort of giving up on life. But the daughter remembered that he was a very, very great music fan. In fact, in his younger days, people used to call him Dr. Mukesh because he used to sing like that famous singer Mukesh. And when she started encouraging him to pull out all his old records and cassettes, to once in a while, if possible, attend some music program and all that, his entire demeanor has changed. It can be done. Usha says, what happened? Hi Ali, do depressed people resort to alcohol? No, it is not that depression leads to alcohol, or alcohol is a cause of or a consequence of depression, nothing like this. That's a completely different topic altogether. People resort to alcohol for various other means. Maybe that's a good idea that you've told me. Maybe I'll pick that up as a topic and we will discuss it in one of these Saturdays. Okay, Karthik says, becoming less emotional, suppress emotions, and more practical, logical helps to reduce depression. No, not necessarily, Karthik. What happens is that if you become too logical and too, you know, analytical or whatever it is, sometimes it can be contraindicated. So let us not, you know, look at that as a remedy. Accept the emotions, accept the fact that, yes, I had this failure, I had this setback, I have this thing because of which I am very upset or whatever it is. We can't take it along. Okay. Surekha says, when they made a tire that would absorb the shocks of the road, that tire could take it. We will last a lot longer and enjoy smoother riding if we learn to absorb the shocks, the jolts during the rocky road of life. And the way to absorb life's upsets is through the cultivation of unconditional acceptance of the experiences life brings us every single moment. Very well said, Surekha. As usual, Surekha comes out with these gems which I truly appreciate. But yes, if you just look at the sum total of what she said, that if you become like a tire which can absorb the shocks of life, You don't know further along the road where there are going to be ditches, where there are going to be bumps and potholes. But if you have that tire which is running you through, you can definitely deal with it better. Okay. Pushpalata says the biggest problem with them, they don't agree they have a problem and they need to get help. How to deal with this type of situation? Yes, if a person is not agreeing that I have depression, just make him talk about the symptoms. You are suffering a lot because of this bad boss. You are feeling very, you know, upset because of the relationship with ex is going. I don't want you to suffer. You are capable and you deserve a good life. So if you are open to it, can we look for ways and means how we can resolve this thing? Keep the word depression aside. Talk about the symptom that the person is going through, which he will obviously acknowledge, and work on those things. Sweka says, the worst thing about depression is that you don't feel anything. No pain, no happiness, you feel empty. Yes, Sweka. That is something we need to be aware of. That feeling of emptiness, that feeling of hopelessness, it can really be killing. And in extreme cases, you are aware that people who go into depression and dysthymia and all this emptiness, they may even get suicidal. So before it goes anywhere in that direction, let us work towards overcoming it. It's not the load that breaks you down, it's the way you carry it. Don't sweat the small stuff and then recognize that it is all small stuff. This too shall pass, they say. No. Ke sara sara, whatever will be, will be. The simple things, but these are the things that help you build up an attitude not only to fight, overcome, and succeed against depression today, but forever. Aditi says, but Ali, we cannot always help someone at a distance. True, I agree. I could see my sister-in-law in depression and thought only of the physical issues. Even her sisters who are close to her only want to blame us and fuel the emotions. Main issue, they were childless and my brother is no more. Yes, that's a very tragic situation. It's something very sad to happen to anybody. It has happened to her. But how she is going to deal with it, how she is going to struggle and overcome it, that is where our role comes in, where we can help such people. First, acknowledge that yes, life has treated you badly. You are going through a bad thing. If she is pessimistic and she says, I have no future left, acknowledge it. Yes, today it does look to you that there is no future, there is nothing left for you. And then slowly start exploring with her small ways and means. Like I gave you the example of that doctor, you know, who is very fond of old music and how music today has helped him to overcome that depression, which came because of, primarily because of health issues. Sharayu says, setbacks in life many a time cause depression, but surrounding people and situation worsens it. That's very true. Many a times it becomes contagious in a family or in a workplace. And when you recognize that, we should immediately take precautions. Dr. Sharayu is a highly qualified doctor herself. If somebody's child goes out and gets wet in the rain and comes back, he's not sick. But we still tell the person that immediately change the clothes of the child, dry his head, give him something warm to drink. We are doing preventive work. The same preventive work can be done for depression and it can be done very successfully. Pushpalata says, if a person is suffering with depression, people should also treat them with dignity, respect. In many cases, they brand them mad or crazy. Yes, that's what that sometimes we say, this person has become lazy, this person is mad, this person has got some witchcrafts and all that. I'm really surprised that even in the 21st century, among highly educated and well-to-do people, we still have these myths. But each one of us, to whatever little or greater extent we can do, we should do in order to contribute towards creating a little nicer and a little more positive and a little more happier world all around us. So with that, let me wind up, and I will request Anis to quickly run you through those slides once again, so those of you who missed out can have a look at that. But before that, we have our forthcoming programs. Next Saturday, 26th, is Preparing for Marriage, and I have, you know, written very clearly, yours or others. So anybody, you know, watching that doesn't mean that you're going to get married. You may be happily married, you continue, or you may be happily unmarried and want to continue also. But to help people also, you know, who are at that threshold of marriage. And then 2nd November is Diwali. So we will not be having a session on that day. And then the next, that is 9th of November, we'll be having, it's been a request from people. We had done this topic long back, but there was a request to have a session on facing gaslighters, you know, people who try to manipulate your thoughts and try to put you down and try to make you feel guilty and try to, you know, control your thoughts and all these things. So these are our forthcoming topics. Anis will quickly run you through the slides which were shown to you, and we will wind up. Thank you. Bye-bye.
If you approve it, then we'll tell them. Amen.